So you guys remember how in the Fast and the Furious movies, Paul Walker and Vin Diesel were in the first one, and then only Paul Walker was in the second one, and then the third one didn't have either Paul Walker or Vin Diesel, really. And then how the fourth, fifth, and sixth ones actually happened between the second one and the third one, and the seventh one follows after that. That's a little bit what's going on with the sequence of episodes of the PowerCast right now. We were in Manhattan last week, and Mark and I recorded an episode with Gary Vaynerchuk. I pushed it forward because it was already in Gary's Daily V, his daily vlog. Part of it was, so it made sense to push this one forward ahead of some of the other ones in the pack. So anyway, things you need to know about the setup here. Mark, back in the early days of Slingshot, was given an audio version of Gary's book, Crush It, by his dad. Some of the concepts in there, especially related to promoting businesses through social media, really rung true with Mark and his wife, Andee. And so they use those as guiding principles in growing the Slingshot business. So Mark has always obviously wanted to talk to Gary V pretty much since we started this podcast. And through our friend Tim Ferriss, this was actually accomplished. So last week we were in Manhattan. We recorded in Gary's offices. We were on the 25th floor of an amazing building. It was absolute beehive of activity. You can actually hear people working in the background. Even though the doors were closed, you know, it was impossible to really keep all the sound out because it was just such a busy place. Recording is a little bit different mics, different setup. There are two walls of windows in that room, and so everything's a little different. Anyway, we had an amazing time talking to Gary. There are about four things you should know about Gary as we go into this. One of them is that Gary's family immigrated from the Soviet Union in the late 70s. In the late 90s, Gary took over management of his dad's liquor store, rebranded it as Wine Library, started selling online, started making videos that he called Wine Library TV, which were wine reviews that went up every day. Some of the wine he carried and some of it he didn't, and he didn't really care where people bought it. He just wanted to inform people about different wines, and it was incredibly successful. It went from about $3 million a year to about $60 million a year in the course of 5 or 6 years. So hugely successful. That allowed him to become an early investor in companies like Twitter and Uber, Facebook, Venmo, some of the bigger companies of the last 10, 15 years. Gary has transitioned to running Vayner Media, which is a social media-based digital marketing agency. Some of their Fortune 500 clients include Anheuser-Busch, Pepsi, General Electric, et cetera, et cetera. Hugely successful company, about 750 people in the building and their production facility, which is in another part of Manhattan. Just an amazing company and literally the most influential person we've ever had on the PowerCast. And the final thing that you need to know that's important is that Gary has become, over the last few years, a fitness enthusiast. He works out 7 days a week, even if it's just he's doing soft tissue work. He has a trainer named Jordan Syatt. When he was 19, which was about 5 or 6 years ago, went and spent 6 months with Louis Simmons at Westside Barbell as an intern so he could learn from arguably the best strength coach ever. So Gary shared a lot of how fitness fits into his life. He talked a lot about the state of social media in fitness. He talked just a lot about how to succeed. So we had a great time talking to Gary. Please enjoy this episode. It is like no other in the canon of the PowerCast so far. I think that it is far worth your while to spend the time with this one. So enjoy this episode. Like and share it. Seriously, like and share this episode. If you've never shared any episode of the PowerCast before, share this one. There's a lot of information here that can impact your daily life. Seriously, especially if you're an entrepreneur, especially if you're trying to make a business of fitness, but not 100%. If you're trying to make a business of anything, even just your career, there's a lot to learn here. So anyway, we'll be back next week with the episode that I originally intended to run this week with Chris Bell. Support for this episode of the PowerCast comes from HowMuchABench.net, home of Mark Bell's Slingshot. Bench heavy with no pain with Mark Bell's Slingshot. Apparel for strong people at 8manstrong.com and bodybuilding.com. Bodybuilding.com is the world's largest fitness website and supplement store. Bodybuilding.com has free fitness plans for every level. Visit bodybuilding.com today to become your best self. Happy to welcome back Compex USA as a sponsor. Go to ComplexUSA.com and check out all the great muscle stim products there. We have all used them. They are the best we've ever used. Use the code PowerCast at checkout to get 28% off of everything but the lowest price model. ComplexUSA.com.
With Gary V.
Thank you.
This is incredible. This is really awesome for me to be here today. I got my man Jim McD, who's been with me from the very beginning. He's kind of seen all the stuff I've had grow over the years.
He was a bouncer driving a beat up Chrysler 300 when I met him.
I love it.
Pretty much.
Where was that?
Well, you guys were living in Davis at the time,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, that was
California.
Back in 2005?
Five, yeah.
2006, somewhere 2005. In there.
You read Crush It?
Read a book called Crush It.
How'd you get it?
You may have heard of it. My dad was into it. My dad's a huge mentor to me, much like your dad is to you. And he's the one who kind of told me about it. I was like, Dad, I'm not really into reading. You know, I hate to read.
Yeah, me too.
It's a huge challenge for me. So I get the audio book, and it's you narrating it. And I go, oh my God, this guy's annoying as hell.
Yeah. that's right.
This guy's got a lot of fire. But once I started listening to it more, I was like,
able to get through that, right?
I was able to get through that just fine.
Some people don't.
Well, the reason I'm able to get through it is because I realized very quickly into the book that that's who you are.
Yeah.
So when somebody's trying to be amplified or over the top
for
bullshit reasons, then I'm like, fuck this guy.
I get it. I'll take anybody in their pure form.
Right.
Anybody.
And I enjoyed it a lot, and some of the general principles you shared in that book helped me and my wife tremendously. And I mentioned to your team, I said, you know, before we read the book, we were bums, we had nothing, and now we're doing really well. So thank you so much.
You can't even imagine what that feels like. That is actually something I've been telling people, which is that feeling of impacting people in its pure, back to purest form. Mm-hmm. I just wish everybody could feel it, because it feels fucking good.
Yeah.
Thank you for that.
No, it feels great. And that's what I was sharing with Jordan earlier today, your trainer here. I was sharing the same thing with him. Like, you might make a video, no one's going to watch it. You might put out a book, or no one's going to read it, and so on. But you have to keep going, right? You have to keep putting that information out there.
Always one piece of content away from everything changing. It's crazy. It's true.
I love the quote that you have out there about, it's not about how many people like you or this or that. It's about how many people show up at your funeral.
Yep.
And my grandfather had probably about 800 people at his funeral, you know, back in, I don't know, even remember the year it was, but I just remember that.
There was so many people.
That
right?
Had a
How
huge,
old were you?
I was probably about, I don't know, 20 or so?
About 25.
Yeah, about 25 when he passed away.
But it hit you.
That had a huge impact.
Because you didn't know how many people were going to show up.
Yeah. I didn't understand how.
And you know what's interesting about a lot of, you know what's funny? A lot of the old timers, unlike me, who tells everybody what he's doing and how it's going to happen, a lot of those guys and gals kept their mouths shut about it.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, all these people showed up and they're telling, I get, because I talk a lot about having a lot of people come to my funeral. Yeah. I get emails of really interesting stories and people tell me things like, 500 people showed up and we thought 8 were going to show up, and they told me my grandpa lent him money or mowed his lawn or
Yeah.
It's cool.
I had the same experience when my best friend passed away. He was a colonel at the Pentagon, and he had a ton of people at his funeral, and everybody was saying these fantastic things about him. Like, I knew he was a great guy, but there are people saying that he changed the course of their lives, and like, have I done that for anybody? Like, how many pallbearers can I pull together, you know?
I get it.
Jordan here told me that fitness has changed your life and it's putting a lot of money in your bank account.
Is that true?
I absolutely did not say that.
It's been putting money in your bank account.
He actually said the kind of almost the exact opposite.
You know, it's really interesting. A lot of people ask me about getting into better shape over the last couple of years. You know, it's so funny. It's the same way I think about business and life. It's unbelievable to me that I don't necessarily feel so much better. Like, we keep, you know, and you guys probably are more grounded in this. It's been fun to like realize you keep finding new spots. Like, oh shit, now I've realized my shoulder. We've been like, this is literally last week. You don't know it. I didn't know it I knew that I was not doing anything that was smart with my eating or physical fitness 3 years ago, which is why I started doing it.
You kind of stuff it under the table.
Yeah, I did it because I knew I wasn't doing the right behavior.
Right.
But to say I feel so different, there's a couple little things. Like, I know when I cut Carrie Zander down the street, when I hit one armed for four blocks and don't get tired after three steps, that makes sense, grabbing my luggage. But energy-wise, I don't feel any different because I have so much natural energy.
You had a lot of energy anyway.
But even though I don't feel these remarkable short-term results, I know how this plays out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I know what my life looks like at 74 because I'm gonna work out every day between 38 and 74. I'm gonna be in good shape.
Someone famous in the powerlifting community once said, strength is never weakness. That's something I share with people all the time because no one's ever said, I wanna have less money. No one's ever said, I wish I got my ass kicked more when I got in a fight.
That's exactly right.
Nobody wants to be weaker.
No.
Right. Everybody wants to try to find a way to get better.
Yeah, that's right.
A lot of people...
Most people just aren't willing to pay the price.
That's true.
Most people aren't willing to pay the price for what their mouth puts out there.
But that's sort of... It's true of everything, right?
Yes. I mean, work... You know, it's so funny. It's been so interesting getting my act together health-wise and the emergence of Instagram and having all these very fit people show up in your feeds.
Right.
You see these people who really understand how to treat their body. Eating... physical therapy, and all their friends who don't, they are always looking for shortcuts from their fit friends. What can I do that's quick?
Yeah.
Like, what can I do, right? And everybody who's real and doesn't have any bullshit to sell knows that there's no shortcut.
Right.
Yet, all these same trainers then go try to build their business, sell t-shirts, supplements, courses, and all they want is shortcuts. And I'm fascinated by people who, in either direction, know exactly what it takes in one part of their lives, but then in the part that doesn't come as natural, default into the short and quick and fake.
I think they see their physical condition as their leverage, and they think that everything else should just turn on that.
That's right. What they also don't understand is supply and demand.
Right.
Like, I never knew there were so many attractive people on Earth until Instagram came along. Like, you have to understand supply and demand.
Right,
yeah.
There's a lot of people with a good booty.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like you, all of a sudden you're not the best in shape and cutest in just your gym. Mm-hmm. You've got to compete against the world. And so maybe you can't command, you know, you might have been like the cutest guy in your high school, but when you went to college and competed against another 14,000 guys, like you might be in the mix,
right?
Yeah.
But you're no longer like, you know, you got to understand supply and demand.
The pond got bigger.
What we've seen in our community is people's lifts getting a lot better. So I'm watching him, and you're watching this guy, and watching that guy, and because the lifts have gotten so much bigger, now it's what a 700-pound deadlift used to be kind of the norm. Now we're
the
seeing
norm
more
is like exceptional.
Well, now we're seeing in powerlifting. Now we're seeing 800, 900, and 1,000-pound deadlifts. What do you think Instagram has done for business? Has it done something similar where they're seeing somebody like you and it's driving them to push themselves?
That's a really good observation. So I think what that does when you have more awareness of everything, what it does is exposes people. So I don't think there's a general answer of that, right? Winners say, fuck, 750, I'm going 760.
Right.
A lot of people go the other way and get discouraged and bow out. It's the way I think about rich kids. I've succumbed, it was something I tried, I don't know how I thought I was gonna fix this, but like, I'm aware that my children are gonna grow up extremely well off. And they're going to do one of two things once they realize what I'm up to. They're going to look at that and they're going to say, what I did with my dad, which for where we were seemed like a big accomplishment, I'm going to climb that mountain and I'm going to, I mean, I used to tell my dad, like, I'm going to do so much more than you that you're not even, you're going to feel that it's disrespectful to even put up our names. And, I mean, I was so competitive with my own dad. I'm like, you're not even going to say my name because it's going to be disrespectful to compare the two of us. And he would get mad too. We were competitive. But a lot, you know, now I have fancy friends, well-off friends, third generation wealth friends, mm-hmm. and a lot of kids go completely the other way,
yeah.
right? They're gonna be like, well, I'm not gonna climb that. And actually, I kind of feel guilty that I fly in private jets and have a Hamptons home. So what I'm actually gonna do is I'm gonna take mommy and daddy's money and give it away. I'm gonna be a nonprofit, or I'm gonna go build homes, or, and by the way, I'm comfortable with whatever Misha and Xander decide to do. I genuinely am. But that's what happens when you get exposed to big things.
Right.
You either decide to go, and the reason you see 800 and more now is a small percentage of the great winners put in the triple work because they're aware and push it forward. One of the biggest reasons athletes are better in today's world is Magic Johnson didn't know that Larry Bird was taking 5,000 free throws.
Yeah.
They just found each other in college and were like, damn.
Yeah.
Right. Now, everybody's, you know, when you're in 6th, 7th, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 years old, you have real, they're grading kids at such a young, you know where you sit. And it's pushing you harder if you're really that star.
Right.
And so maybe Larry Bird would have taken 3,000 shots if he knew Magic was taking 1,200.
Right. How old are your kids?
7 and 4.
What do you think is most important thing to do with them in terms of, you know, a parent is going to be the one that has to guide their kid. You're gonna have to make your kid do things that they don't want to do, such as like eat vegetables or finish their dinner, and just not eat too much sugar and so on, right? When it comes to
or not. I think one of the great debates that I play with now is what is established cliche eat your vegetables,
right?
And what is actually the value of that in reality,
right?
Truth is, the far majority of people I know probably didn't eat their vegetables or. Definitely anybody who's 41 ate way too much sugar and drank soda 24. I mean, I drank soda every day of my life. Yeah. To me, the things I think most about are number 1, 2, 3, and 4 is to build self-esteem. So my belief is that self-esteem is the only drug that combats the world.
Yeah.
I genuinely
That's
believe
powerful.
It. In parallel, it's imperative that you don't build fake self-esteem.
Right.
Self-esteem can't be manufactured through rewarding, non-rewarding events.
Right. So like participation trophies.
Correct. Yeah. You can't come in 8th place in the race in school and then get prized for that because that's just not real life. Mm-hmm. However, Xander, for example, this weekend, when Max got hurt, his nephew, stopped what he was doing and came over and showed amazing empathy for a 4-year-old. That has become now the thing I've talked to him about for 2 days.
Yeah.
That he's incredible, that you have such a great heart.
Right.
Like, to me, you triple down. This is, by the way, this is me being a byproduct of being what I think perfectly parented. This is what my mom did.
Yeah.
My mom over-exaggerated my natural goodness as a person.
Right.
To make me believe it was like the most important thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And she never gave me 3rd place trophies. And when I lost, I lost. And she made me realize there were repercussions in life, so when I got bad grades, even though she knew I was gonna be very special, I was literally punished. Like, it was like clockwork. You know how like the sun and the moon do their thing? From 5th grade to senior of high school, I was punished every single mid-October, that's the first report card, late December, early March, and the end of the year.
What age?
From literally Forever. From 5th grade, for 7 to 8 years consistently, yeah. I was grounded.
Well. Yeah, learned all that.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think it's interesting. I think that subconsciously I knew that it wasn't the most important thing in the world, but I do like that she punished me and didn't let me completely disrespect the system, but she never let it hurt my confidence.
Right.
Right? She played it very smart, and there is something interesting my parents did. At 14, they said, look, tough guy. You're not gonna be a student, it means you're gonna work. And so that means you're gonna start working now.
Yeah.
And so I do think one of the great things my parents did, and I think a lot of parents should think about this, is if you don't have a student, even if they're an artist and wanna sing and paint, you need to figure out how to establish massive work ethic, because the only thing that's controllable for somebody who's gonna bet on themselves in life is their work ethic. Their talent, you can get better, right? You can lift more, you can get better at things. Right. But some, like, my calves and ass aren't naturally the same as everybody else. And there's people who are naturally like, I don't like, my chest is never gonna be as big as I necessarily want it. And there's certain things that are, right? But meanwhile, like, I'll sell you back the hat you're wearing right now.
Right.
I will. And so I think that, I think it's important to teach work ethic, because work ethic is the only thing that maximizes what you naturally have, and that's really the best you can ask for.
What about sports? What about sports with your children?
I'm very into it. I'm a little worried about what the New York City dynamic of sports is. I didn't grow
sports
up.
Sports are confusing today, it seems like to me. Like, there, you have to be a part of something for so long, and it seems like it just seems like a different commitment.
Here's what I would say. I'm going to use sports a little bit differently. I'm obsessed with competition.
Yeah.
And I think, and I really hope my kids are competitive. One, I'll say it again, I'm not interested in imposing any of my will on them. If they're not competitive, it'll be disappointing because I love it for about 4 seconds, and then I'll trick myself into thinking it's great.
Right.
Like, I'm just gonna go optimistic on it.
Right.
Sports is cool, team sports are cool. I think it teaches people a lot of things.
A lot of messages that they might learn
I love sports. My kids have shown interest in sports this year for the first time in a meaningful way. My daughter especially, which is a lot of fun for me. I'm very weird. I really wanna reverse engineer my kids. I want to pay attention to their reactions, figure out what's driving them, and then quadruple down on it, and then instill the spirit of reality into it.
How do you pay attention to them with so many different things going on?
That's hard. It's hard, and I would tell you that's
like,
probably...
Sometimes you're on your phone, throw it over your shoulder? Or...
No, I think my answer is I try.
Yeah.
First of all, I work too much, so the limited time I have with them, I try to stay focused, but like... I'm selfish in my own stuff too. I think it's important to be. You know, I think one of the things I worry about with a lot of stay-at-home parents, and obviously I don't know what the percentage are, but you know, I think we still live in a world where it's gotta be in the 80s, maybe even 90s that the woman's staying at home. I watch all these, you know, there's incredible women that work for me, women entrepreneurs. When they, you know, it's been interesting for me. It feels like such a difficult game for, you know, guys have it so easy when children come to the equation. I feel like there's an enormous amount of the balance of guilt, of keeping your own identity, of, you know, so many of these women, you know, women are, we're living in a great age where it's not the archaic ages anymore. There's a lot of women that have unbelievable ambitions, the greatest ambitions, equal to the ambitions of men, which they didn't have 50, 60, 30, 90 years ago. And so, like, that transition seems very difficult. And I think when you lose yourself in your children, you lose.
Yeah.
You lose. Which then means your children lose. One of the things that I'm very, very obsessed with is I can't believe how many parents wrap their own self-esteem into their children's accomplishments.
Yeah, it's wild, isn't it?
So this has been the big eye-opener for me. This was probably the one thing I think I anticipated quite a bit about parenting.
Right.
I think I nailed it. I'm good at predicting shit. Here's where I missed by a mile. Like, literally, it struck me at a parent event. I was like, wait a minute. You actually feel better about yourself because your kid can play chess. You love your kid and you're happy for your kid. No, you think you're better because you're the parent of the chess player.
I think you're a badass.
It blew me away. My parents never wrapped their self-esteem in me. I wrap my self-esteem in only myself. Not even my parents. I couldn't even I'm very empathetic, which is why I'm a good salesman, why I'm successful. And that's my gift, gratitude and empathy. I wasn't empathetic to that because I hadn't lived it, I never tasted it, I never understood it. And then it opened up everything. Like, that's why people put bumper stickers of like Harvard, you know.
Right.
I'm like, oh shit. That's why parents force their kids into collecting debt to go to a university that makes the parent feel good versus the kid going to a secondary school or a community college where they don't. Like, it unlocked a whole world of like, fuck you, parents.
I saw that in Little League with my older son. There were two of the assistant coaches for his team. They would have to call the sheriff to calm them down, because if there was a call at home plate that they didn't like, or a strike or whatever.
That I actually agree with. I want to fight. I get sports muscles. That to me is a little, that could be a nuance of that. That could be true. Uh-huh. If Rick wants to fight because he thinks he's little Timmy and he's a great baseball player. Uh-huh. I would just fight because I just want my kid's team to win the game. Yeah, I just want to win the game. But it
does get pretty heated, doesn't it?
To me, those kind of things actually don't really freak me out as much as the politically correct world gets freaked out. I just don't think it makes any sense in the world. You're a parent. Your number one thing in the world is to do everything right by that child. Like, they're at your mercy. They're like your kid.
Yeah.
And parents are misfiring. They're selfish.
Have you ever heard this quote before? The best way to have an impact on the world is to go home and love your family. Ever heard that before?
Mm-mm.
It's by Mother Teresa.
Is that right?
Yeah. I think it's great. It makes a lot of sense to me, because I'm trying to impact, you know, lifters like this. Yeah. I'm trying to impact trainers.
Yes.
And people in the fitness industry, and I'm super excited about it. Then I'm at home and I'm in my phone.
I get it, man.
And my little girl's saying, it. Daddy, Daddy, Daddy. And I'm like, what am I, why am I doing this?
I get it. And I think that's right. And I also think, you know, I think it comes down to your circumstance too.
Right.
So I'm the son of a first generation immigrant who worked every minute, left before I woke up, came home after I slept in the home that I slept in every single night, took zero travel days. So was in the same home. My dad slept in this is not a divorce, this is not a traveling right. father like I am. This is my father slept in the same home that I slept in my entire life. I just want everybody to hear this, because this is insane actually in hindsight. From the day I was born to the day I left, like all of them. Like old school, like just came home every night. I don't know what else to tell you. And I never saw him once. And when I tell you I never saw him once, I spent more time with my kids this President's Day weekend than my dad did with me my entire childhood combined.
Yeah.
Like, I just want people, like, I don't think people really, like, you know, even.
Was
like,
there ever a term of being resentful, or was it like,
didn't
no,
even cross my mind.
Okay.
What was your impression?
Thank God dad worked so hard. We came from nothing. Now we have a townhouse.
Right.
That's what it was. Mm. It was gratitude. It was optimism. Right. And there wasn't a need. My mom was so incredible.
You're coming from
and
a
again,
totally different
every kid's yeah. different. I didn't need my dad. Did I notice that a lot of people's dads were at the Little League games? Mm. Absolutely. Did my dad went to one Little League game my entire career, and I was pumped, and I did good. It was an all-star game. I played well. Like, but again, I was a kid that didn't need it. I didn't need my dad. I definitely needed my mom. You need something, but like, yeah. I didn't need anything. Mm-hmm. I've never been somebody who validates himself on anything on the outside, and that is a gift. And I think that goes back. You have two kids.
Yeah.
Look, they're gonna be different. Right? They're different. And so, like, you gotta look, like Misha, my daughter, reminds me of me. She never gave a shit that I would leave the house. Bye, Dad. Misha may be gone for 4 days. Mm-hmm. I'll be back. Bye, Dad. My little guy's like not. And I'm like, oh, fuck. I didn't realize how good I had it with Misha. Like, this actually hurts my feelings. I'm emotional. This is sad. Like, and you'll adjust. The other thing is, I just sent Tyler, my admin, like, hey, this is where I was going with this. This is very long-winded to the thing that I, how old are your kids?
13 and 9.
Right, so you guys are really in this zone. You know how you said the vegetables thing?
Right.
I'm very against that. Let me explain what I mean.
I'm against vegetables too. Let's make a fucking stand together.
Actually, here's a huge irony. You know this. I love vegetables. I'm against the cliche thing. So yeah. One of the biggest conversations I'm having with my wife right now is like, look, Lizzie, I go to Oslo, Hong Kong, Melbourne. I'm going on all these amazing trips. I'm like, you need to start. I know that you're a little bit more by the book, it's my wife. Like, I need you to be open to what I wanna do, which is Misha's gonna miss 13 days of school a year that make no sense. And that's because I'm gonna take her to Oslo. Mm-hmm. And she's gonna see what daddy does, and we're gonna spend 6 hours on the 8 hours on the plane together, and then I'm gonna take an extra, what will change,
right.
And you change. Right now, I'm in every place. I'm not, when I sleep in one place twice, we slept in Belgium 2 nights, it's weird. I stay nowhere more than one night. Nowhere.
Serious.
Trips are to Europe and Asia. These are 8-hour trips, 9-hour trips, 13-hour trips. They are insane.
We didn't even stay a night in Ireland. Went and left.
Right, I went to Dublin and didn't even, like, never even slept there, right? Like, wow. Went from New York overnight to Dublin. Dublin speech, get on a plane, go to Belgium. That's why we had two nights in Belgium.
Right.
Like a rock star. So, that's insane. But now I'll adjust. Now that the kids, you know, you get to adjust. You get to be a parent forever.
Yeah.
All these parents want to win in the first inning.
Right.
Right? Yeah. There's more to it now. I do think the early years are foundational. I don't disrespect them. I do think feelings get formulated at 6, 9, 12, 14, 19 that may be harder. But right. let's be honest. I need people to understand. I'm going to paint a picture that everybody knows is true and should really make all parents feel better about themselves and not make them crippled. How many times do you need to see a child reunited with a parent that did everything wrong? Walked out on them. Didn't give a crap about them.
Right.
Cheated on their spouse. Stole the money. Were an alcoholic. Drank. It takes the kid but 5 minutes to like get one or two things off their chest right. and they're back into the need to rebuild that relationship. Right. These are our children.
Like it's this so baked thought, in.
It's so baked in, my man. And modern nitpicking and political correctness is trying to scare us into thinking we're fucking this up.
Which is how we get helicopter parents. Correct. Because they're so afraid of doing something wrong. Yeah.
Yeah. Like so look. Do I wish I spent more time with my kids? Of course. Do I think the things that I'm doing will impact my kids in a positive way? Absolutely.
Yeah.
I genuinely do.
Well, supply and demand, the scarcity, they appreciate the time
with
you,
right?
Yeah,
and I don't want to win on, you're right. And I don't want to win on that. But you're not wrong. And I don't want them to take their mother for granted because she deserves the like so much. I'd be more reactionary to that because of that, because I think she deserves it. I hate when people get taken for granted. I live my life getting taken for granted because of the way I roll. So I'm very anti that. So I won't be a hypocrite and do that to my wife. You know, and then I'm like, I break every rule because I want to like, you know, it's so amazing. It's so hard coming from nothing.
Yeah.
I don't want to give them anything. Mm-hmm. I want to give them everything, you know? I think we all go through, listen, there's nothing I've said that every parent isn't there shaking their head about right. because we're all living it. Here's the thing I am saying that's different. You're doing way better than you think.
Right.
I'm just tired of this. Like, first of all, I don't give a shit about what your opinion is on how I'm parenting. They're my kids, fuckface. Yeah. Like, and more importantly, my mom was snickered at her whole life because they never went anywhere. There were no family vacations. Yeah. She parented me. And all the Brooklyn Russian families, they go, the second they made a few bucks, they went on every cruise and this and that.
A bunch of money.
And now, at every Russian wedding, my parents are put on a throne because of the way that our three kids ended up right. by comparison.
That's amazing.
And so to that point, why I told that story is one, to give my parents credit, and two, this plays out. You could have opinions about how I'm parenting. Let's see how it plays out.
It's a long game.
Yeah.
Let's see who has better kids.
I think the other thing you mentioned.
See which kids are winners and happy. And winning comes in different forms. I know miserable billionaires. I know a kid right now grew up with nothing but money. He's successful right now. And what does he do every night? He does coke every night. That's what he does. And, you know, like, he's going to lose.
Right.
Like, right? And then
it's
I know
not
kid.
Play out well,
right. Yeah. But everybody, because of his Instagram, thinks he's winning. You think he's winning. He lost. Meanwhile, I have friends that I grew up with, great parenting, still live in Hunterdon County, New Jersey. Like, going to the mall is like the legit thing,
right?
And they've won. So it's not just winning on like who, like, right?
Their
like,
goal is to buy like, a boat and go fishing
right,
every
weekend. My parents aren't heralded because of what I've achieved. Yes, because of what I've achieved, but who I am.
I think what you said earlier about being selfish is really important. And something I preach a lot of times at seminars too, is that you have to go out there and you have to figure out a way to take care of yourself. And
first.
Do the things that you love to do.
First.
So if you love doing this and you love being here, this is crucial. Then you can't take care of him. You can't take care of him.
First.
And the 500 other people that work inside this building.
750 and and first. I'm the engine. If I break, everybody else is fucked.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, for me, what really got lucky was I'm built like my mom, which is my fuel for that engine is to make other people happy, which makes me popular. Which makes me even more popular with the people that know me the best, which is really, by the way I judge myself. The way I basically have been judging myself through this really interesting path I'm living right now right. is, do the people that know me the best like me the most?
Yeah, like, is he pumped about going to Belgium with you, or is he like, fuck, man? Like, it's a paycheck.
Or inevitably, like, when he's getting 6 or 7 DMs a month of like, is his shtick? Like, back to the first rate, like, my stuff comes off like a shtick because I'm an anomaly.
Right.
I am over-energized. I am pumped. I am more grateful. I am louder. I am like more confident. I am different. I am. I'm different. And I like that. I like when...
I got a legit message the other day asking if you were a real human. Someone legitimately messaged me. Is he a real human like me?
He's a real
human. You get that, Ty?
He's not a robot.
I mean, I get those. I've had people like DM me asking if we plant people that come up to you on the street. Like,
oh, that's pretty good.
That's a good one. Yeah. See, like to me, that like that's just funny.
Yeah, that's
like
hilarious.
When I hear that, I would think that if I planted a human to take a selfie with me to act cool in a Daily V, that single move would crumble my entire empire. Because what? Then I would have to make all these people that actually know, I'd have to keep them on the payroll. I want to fire these guys. I'm being serious. Like the one of the biggest reasons, I have no interest in being held hostage.
Right.
The reason you need to live naked is because you don't want anybody to have leverage over you. Right. I'm not letting anybody have the upper hand on me. He would have the upper hand if I needed to make sure that he told them, no, you know, fuck that. And you can't hold those plates. Eventually one falls and then it's over. So one of the reasons I live that kind of life is leverage.
How's your wife been? Has she been a part of a lot of the success of what you built up?
She's the foundation of my success. She's the enabler of my success. If my wife wasn't so selfless, I wouldn't be what I am today. And you know what? As a young man, I didn't understand that. You know, like...
It seemed like you're so driven to even just... You're kind of born that way. And that's full blast.
16, like the thought like that, like if my mom, you know, as I grew up, my mom's teaching me to be a good man. We'd have these conversations and I'm like, Mom, you didn't build the liquor store.
Right.
Dad built the liquor store. Yeah. The hell are you taking credit for?
Why are you saying we and us?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, and of course... You know, what you realize is when you start tasting life is I spend 0 minutes worrying about what Lizzie's thinking anytime, always, which allows me to do 100% my thing.
Right.
Which is a gift and a curse. One, it's such a blessing to have someone like that be your support system. Second, it's daunting because I'm just always petrified to take it for granted. And she does what I do. That's why I think we love each other so much, because we're similar in our real cores and we love ourselves so much that I think it makes us appreciate the other one. She's a big deal.
Can you talk about the business to her and she gets it, or just no?
No. And by the way, I could, and she's more than capable. She's got it like that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to.
Okay.
I actually don't talk about the business at all. Like, I keep it very, like, even, like you know, it's funny to have Jordan here, like, I spend as much time with Jordan as I do with my wife. Like, see him every day for an hour, and it's like, you know, I don't complain, I don't talk about stuff. Once in a blue moon, if, like, the things I've told him have been more predicated on trying to teach him how to be a businessman than the need to get it out.
Mm. You're trying to share what you know.
Yeah. I like it. I'm a great like teammate, coach, lead. I'm a great leader. I just know it. I'm a great leader because I care about them more than I care about myself, which then makes them care enough about me that it matters. It's fun to have Tyler here instead of you. Tyler literally came here to work for me for a year, learn. I guess I'm speaking for you, I'm just a front. Get the brand association, get the exposure.
Steal from you and leave.
I would call it like get return value.
Right.
Because, you know, I feel like there are people who want to do that part. And by the way, the best part is I'm fine with that too.
Yeah, whatever.
Because I'm on to the next thing the next day. But very quickly, and we had this conversation, how quickly did you realize, maybe I shouldn't just stay for a year, maybe I should play this out a little bit longer? Like how quickly? Like seriously, don't bullshit me.
Like the first month or two of being on the team.
That's it. That's great leadership.
Yeah.
That, right? Young man comes with a plan for his own and realizes, wait a minute, there's so much good here for me. Maybe he's not doing that because he's been tricked by me. He's doing it because he thinks it's in his best interest.
to be part of something bigger.
100%. Mike, who was my last trainer before Jordan, the last couple of months, I could tell he was like maybe I shouldn't leave. Like, right? Yeah.
He made YouTube videos. He was like, I'm really second guessing this. I've already been like, I'm probably gonna stay longer than 3 years. Like, he's gonna push boxing back.
I want to do boxing next.
I heard I'm actually gonna box on Friday. I used to box as a kid, and one of our neighbors used to box, and so I said, dude, you gotta shake my hand right now and pick me up at 6 a.m. because otherwise I won't fucking go. We'll just talk about it. But I'm excited about that. You know, you talked kind of recently about return on investment, and you talked about how that's everyone's kind of like first thought is, how do I get my money back? How do I get my money back on this Facebook post, this Instagram post, and so
tactics.
On.
Tactics. Tactics over religion.
Yeah, I've heard you talk about that before. So my gym is free. And when I made my gym free years ago, somebody said, why'd you make your gym free? And I said, to become a millionaire. And my friend, who it was Dick Lickerson, as we call him. Well, long story.
Not his real name, still.
Go figure.
Yeah, long story.
He's the intro voice of the podcast.
Is he?
Fact. Yeah, he's got amazing voice.
He just kind of tapped me on the shoulder. He's like, I believe in what you just said. Like, I can see it in your eyes. I know what you're getting at.
That's cool.
And so the whole reason for making the gym free was a bunch of reasons. But reason number one was to pay it back to powerlifting. I've gotten so much out of powerlifting. I've gotten so much having
cool.
a team and having people around me to kind of lift me and push me forward that I felt amazing about it. But in your situation, you know, how do you get back your return, maybe in a different way, and it's not money?
Money.
It's still money.
And I'm making a joke. I think that people are not smart. And let me tell you what I mean by that. I am so confused by people's inability to understand what's happening. Everything is predicated on action.
Right.
Like, it's just actions. I don't listen to what anybody says. I just pay attention to what they do. So for me, you know, I have very big ambitions, but one thing that I don't think, I'm blown away by people not remembering that for 13 years of my life out of school, I didn't build a brand. I wasn't speaking. I wasn't Gary Vee. My name was Gary Vaynerchuk, and I worked in a liquor store every single day, and I built an e-commerce business and built fulfillment. These are things I don't talk about. I invented fulfillment. I didn't know it. I didn't go to school for fulfillment. I invented fulfillment for myself. You know,
you made being an entrepreneur cool, which before just meant you didn't have a job.
And I don't think I did it. I
you've been part of it.
I think I've been a small piece of it, but a very small piece. I will tell you, I think that it was the Facebook movie that made it cool.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I think it's the extreme wealth at such a young age. Billionaires were 60 and old, and no 18-year-old could associate with that. When they were like, wait a minute, that dude's a billionaire and he's wearing a hoodie and sneakers and he's 27, that changed everything.
Right.
I think I rode the wave that was created more so than helped. You know, like, now the good thing is it was my truth. Unlike everybody else who was like meant to be a trainer, but now says they're an entrepreneur and a trainer because it's cool, or they want to sell swag on Instagram. Mm-hmm. Or, you see where I'm going?
Yeah.
What's been fun for me is it's my truth.
Right.
Like that's fun, right? This isn't a fly-by-night thing. This was my truth. I think, to answer your question, it's not the money. Anybody that's really smart would know, I knew how to make money before I became me. I made money before I became me. When I invested in Twitter and Tumblr and Uber, that was before I became who everybody knows me as.
Right.
I don't need to monetize my audience. I'll take this opportunity to make sure you use it. I don't begrudge people that monetize their audience. I'm just reminding them that I don't.
Right.
It's an important conversation. And somebody will jump in and say, well, yeah, Gary, what about your books and your t-shirts? And then I would say again, you are not smart, because if you understood the economics behind that in comparison to what I do, I will make more money giving one speech than I will in everything I do in t-shirts this entire year.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Don't you think it'd be smarter for me to do that? I do it because it's fun. I like somebody wearing a t-shirt with my quote on it because I am vain and I like it, right? And like, I like giving them out because everybody, I noticed, like, again, people are not smart. When I started this 60 Second Club and it's working for me on Instagram, I'm giving away my books. A lot of people have the books. So if I create t-shirts, it's something for me to give back, which creates even more of a relationship. And by the way, I want to remind everybody, I am by hand, not somebody here. You know this. Me, by hand, going into my comments, reading it, replying that they won, tagging them, right, screenshooting it, drawing, like, you know, I'm like, I'm doing it.
Yeah.
And so my answer is very simple. I want to leave a legacy. I want to be the greatest, most admired entrepreneur of all time. And I want to do it by not amassing the most wealth. I want to do it by amassing the most wealth and give back to the community in parallel, because I'm leaving enormous amounts of money on the table by doing what I'm doing in content. And you know, do people not remember all these people cost me money? He cost me more money than all the money I'll make on t-shirts this year. It's not a good trade.
Son of a bitch. They don't charging a lot.
You know,
back
like
there.
They don't get it.
Yeah.
And by the way, I am not mad, because 99% of the people are not good enough business people to go through the whole process in their brain. So I'm not mad. I just disagree with people's opinion when they, you know, and I laugh at what their comments, and I enjoy the negative comments in social, because it drives me and reminds me that one, I need to respect and be grounded at all times, and two, that I'm just dramatically smarter than a lot of people.
So we got you deadlifting, we got you into some fitness.
Yes.
How do we get you on a cycle of steroids?
So this is a funny conversation. This is vegetables to me. And I brought this up to you. Now, I don't think I'm going to do it because I think I'm too grounded in its vegetables. But I'm not educated. But I can tell you right now, I'm very fascinated from the couple of... So the reason I don't want to speak about this is less about me not wanting to do steroids, is I don't want to be a hypocrite. I make fun of, and you know this, headline readers.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I know what's going on in Facebook and Snapchat and Instagram.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I know the headlines are, maybe steroids isn't as bad as you necessarily think.
Right.
Maybe after a certain age, it's okay. Maybe not at 16, it's scarier than maybe if you're 45. Like, I'm actually weirdly fascinated by it, but I also know I'm a headline reader. It's a couple of conversations with Mike. It's a couple of conversations with him. It's right. A couple of tweets I've seen. It's a couple of things I've heard. Yeah, but you know, like to me, smoking was fine for you in 1947. I'll tell you right now, I'm way more scared about putting a cell phone to my head and getting brain cancer than steroids. Right. So like, I think people are not smart.
Right. Yeah.
And so I would tell you that if I had to make prediction, I would tell you it's not out of the question for me to do a cycle. I'm being
next
serious.
Time I come back here, you'll be just jacked out of your mind.
It's not out of the question. Now, I am a little bit of a purist, AKA, I'm still enjoying, because, you know, how long have you been working out?
Oh, shit, so that was 12. I'm
good.
40.
So good.
A long time.
So you've seen it. Yeah. Like, this is the first time in my life that I'm actually seeing something happen out of the work you put in.
That's
so I'm enjoying,
awesome.
Right. So I'm actually a pure, like, it's the reason I'm doing, the same reason I'm doing all my own social media is the same reason I would probably not do steroids because of that, because I like doing it.
Right.
More so than me thinking it's bad or what, got it?
Yeah,
that makes
sense.
Yeah.
So if there were steroids that helped people in business, what things would it improve about them?
Emotional intelligence.
Okay.
Empathy, gratitude, self-awareness. The businesses break because human beings break them. Companies don't get bigger because all these assholes want to micromanage everything because it makes them feel better.
If you spread all the world's wealth, they've said before, if you spread all the world's wealth around to everybody equally, it would end up in the pockets of the rich in a very short period of time.
Talent
because
is
the personal development's not
talent
there.
Talent is talent.
Right.
Winners win. Like, that's just the game. And so the people that are not in a path of winning need to do something drastically to break their behavior, because that's why they're not winning. Normally, it's association of something and someone else. One of the things that is driving me more than ever is, for some reason, my communication style penetrates people that are not normally penetrated by communication styles. And to be very frank with you, I feel guilty if I didn't continue down that path, because it's helping people. I mean,
yeah.
I don't know what else to say. It's awesome.
I think when I listen to you, what resonates with me is it almost feels like I'm listening to a podcast or listening to a conversation as if I'm in, I feel like I'm part of it. I feel like I'm in the room as well. And we know from doing this podcast that we've had a similar impact on people where there's been people that are listening to it in their car
and they've shouted stuff out because they felt like they were there. I'll give you a nice compliment. I even feel it while you're doing this. This feels much more like we're actually hanging out than I'm doing
Thank
a podcast.
You. I'll take
genuinely.
That compliment.
And I do a lot of them and some people are good at it.
Right.
But maybe even the dynamic of two of you, like, and maybe actually, no question, because I know myself, having them three here, but like, I feel it.
Yeah. All
right, cool.
Makes sense.
I think that part of it too is that people listen to podcasts with earbuds and it just goes right into their brain.
I'm obsessed with audio. Like, you, and again, watch me, don't listen to what I said. I haven't talked a lot about podcasting.
All right.
But if you guys are, you know, you're consuming me, I rebranded it from the Ask Gary Vee Show to the Gary Vee Audio Experience.
Right.
Right. I started pushing it very aggressively in my social channels. I created a podcast tab on my website. I took it to all platforms, SoundCloud and Spotify. If you really watch every single piece of my content, hired an audio guy because you've seen him in a couple of shots. Yeah. I haven't gotten to tell you about podcasting or anybody about podcasting. One, it's been covered very well. Mm-hmm. I'm not a podcasting pioneer. This has been around. Ferris and Rogan and Lewis Howell. I mean, there's Pat Flynn. There's plenty of people. People have done it. People have talked about it. People understand it. It's just that I'm like, so that's why I keep saying, watch me, don't listen to me.
Makes sense.
Yeah, I think so. Back to, I brought it up earlier, right?
Yeah.
I don't listen to what you're saying. I want to see your act. I love when people are like, I'm a good person. I have never tweeted a single donation I've ever given. I'm more than willing to bring out my tax form right now.
I always think that's weird.
Yeah.
You know, I always think that's weird.
You think it's weird because of how you're grounded.
Yeah.
You think it's weird for the same reason I think it's weird, because you can taste the bullshit behind it.
Doesn't taste very good.
There's only one reason you like me, is because I'm the pure version of it.
That's right.
I know. And so the reason I don't do that is I'm not tricked by somebody saying, just donate it to Haiti after the... They're doing it for their own selves.
One of my favorite things that you talk about is not being fancy.
Yes.
So if we can just end on a fancy rant.
Let's do it. Let's do it.
Then I would be more than satisfied.
Okay, good. You want me to expand on it?
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't think when you make your first fucking dollars, you need a fucking Lambo. Right. I don't understand that people don't understand that, like, I love it. I mean, and listen, again, empathy. You never had anything. You just were broke. I mean, it sounds like, I'd love to know a little more details. Like, I'm not mad if you want to go buy a nice purse or a nice watch. I'm not mad.
Treat yourself.
I think it's important. And by the way, let me talk about a flaw. I actually think I'm very bad at that. I don't celebrate shit. You know, like, fuck. This is actually a conversation between me and my brother.
I think that's excellent in the sense that it will could prevent you from potentially being an addict.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, because you would want to celebrate with alcohol or this or that.
Maybe. But like, no, it's actually way worse than that, my friend. It's like actually like not even acknowledging it. Like it's actually quite scary.
Barry Sanders scoring a touchdown, flipping the ball to the ref.
It's very, you know, it's so funny. I'm such a polar opposite. Like, it's so weird. That's exactly what it is. Yet, until you just said that, I would have thought that I would have been T.O. if I was in football and would have like I was like, you know, and I do think my strength comes in, you know, I often think that I'll call my autobiography, you know, obviously I have the Honey Empire thing now. There's a big part of me that thinks it'd be really funny that I just called it He Did It because when I buy the Jets, you know.
That's right.
But I do think the purest form of my autobiography, like the purest title of my life is going to be The Bridge. I think I pull so hard from opposite directions in a lot of my, like,
right.
You know, like, yeah, I mean, you know what it is?
It's that strongman event. You ever see that? Where the guy's holding the two pillars
actually,
and getting fucking
I'm
going to
articulate it. It's more for you than anything else. At a macro, I'm the least fancy. In a micro, I can be fancy, right? Right? Like.
That makes sense.
Yeah, like in my micro, on stage, but in my, it's almost like in my, it's a steak in the sizzle.
Right.
I got lots of sizzle. But my fucking steak is, you know, like, that's it.
Right.
Right? So fancy. I generally, for your audience, I think that too many of you want stuff, and it's the quickest way to not have stuff.
I make products, and anytime I've gotten fancy, wham, it hits me right back in the face and it doesn't fucking work. And I'm like, fuck, I thought this was such a good idea. I had all these intentions and I had all the best intentions and I tried to fancy it up and it's fucked up.
And I think one of the biggest reasons I'm upset with entrepreneurship through Instagram, Instagram entrepreneurs, actually that's a good new term.
Hashtag.
Instagram Seriously. Entrepreneurs upset me because they only push watches and hot chicks and private planes.
Right.
And it, to me, it's the process. To me, you know, when Jordan and I talk about working out and when he's impressed with me or happy with me, it just makes so much sense to me because I am happy. I don't need to like dress up and go to Equinox. You know, I need to just, you guys sounds, all like that, huh?
That sounds amazing. That's
like, that was a good one?
Yeah, we should do that right now, actually.
I need to just put in the work. Like, I like the grind. I like the process. And I even like this, you know what's funny, and he'll probably tell you this? I like the steps back. I kind of weirdly enjoy, I get mad when I know I had a bad session. And I work out 7 days a week.
Yeah.
Now we also like, one day could be like just, it's like we're just rolling out.
As soft tissue shit.
But I'm there 7 days a week. And some days don't make sense. Like some days was like the day before was a soft tissue day and so I should be super rested and a solid day of sleep and somehow it just didn't click. And other days like he'll go back and actually answer that person. He's not human because I just watched him sleep 3, 4, and 5 hours and have the three best workouts. I don't even understand it. And he's 41. He's like, you know, like, and he wasn't been doing, like, so I like the ups and downs. I love the journey, my man. I love the journey of life. I love the journey of business. I love the journey I'm going through with fitness. I love the process. You have to love the process. If you love the process, you've already won. It's how you fix it.
Right.
The way you fix the game, like the way you hedge it, the way it's like, you fix it, like fixing it. Like I've fixed my outcome.
Yeah.
I don't give a fuck if I buy the Jets. The ambition to and the journey to try to achieve it is the game.
The Jets are so fucked. I've been a fan. I'm from Poughkeepsie, New York. I've been a fan forever, and they've been so,
bad, bro.
They've been so fucked for so long. We got to bring back fucking Ken O'Brien
or
and
Richard
Altoon
Todd.
And Freeman McNeil.
I think the truth is like that only fits my narrative more because when the prodigal son comes home and buys them and brings a championship, I'll get to be the LeBron of the Jets.
Hey, I'll only get a ticket. I'll be satisfied. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Andy, such a pleasure. Yeah.
I should have said this at the top, but joining us in the room are Andee Bell, who is Mark's wife, obviously, Jordan Syatt, who is Gary's trainer, and Tyler Schmidt, who is Gary's assistant. Shout out to all of our sponsors, 8-Man Apparel at 8manstrong.com, bodybuilding.com, the world's largest fitness website and supplement store, Compex Muscle Stim products at Compex USA. Use the code POWERCAST to get a 28% discount. How Much You Bench Not Net, home of Mark Bell's Slingshot. Power, the only strength magazine available in digital and print at thepowermagazine.com. You can follow Gary at Gary V V E E everywhere. You can follow Jordan on Instagram at Syatt Fitness, SyattFitness. You can follow Mark at Mark Smelly Bell. I'm the Jim McD everywhere that I want you to find me on social media. Follow the show on Instagram. We are at Mark Bell's PowerCast. This was the greatest fucking day.